Hello and welcome, my fellow cablators. Today we're going to be talking about the Cablelight XD cams. The Cablelight XD cams we have are the PMW200. These XD cams are a bit older, but they shoot about the same quality as your DSLR, except they do have a little bit of a better color depth. These cameras also have a nice zoom function, a fixed f1.9 lens, and a zoom on the lens that goes from 5.8 to about 82 millimeters, which is a very good range. These lenses are also really nice. These camera sensors will also produce a certain picture quality, similar to how a Canon has their own look or Sony has their look. So in this video, I'm gonna go over some of the different features this camera has and how to operate it. The three cameras I am currently recording on are three of these XD cams. Just like any camera, it's a learning experience as you have to play with the camera to get to know it. So to start off, we'll add a battery. The batteries you use have these pins on the bottom. The pins go facing downwards. You push the battery in, up at the top, push it back, and then push it down until it snaps. To get the battery back out, all you do is push this button right here in, push the battery up, and then pull it out. These cameras use these SBIS cards, and these SBIS cards are similar to an SD card, except they just look a little clunkier. Where you put the SBIS card is in this little flap right here, and in this little flap, you'll press this little button right here. On the SBIS card, there's an arrow. Make sure that arrow is facing upwards when you put this in the slot. This camera has an A and a B SBIS card slot, so that means you can run two SBIS cards and have more storage, and it will automatically switch between cards. Push this little button to turn on the camera. On the front, right here, there is a switch to open the flap. You have two ways to view your image. You have an LCD screen right here, or you have an EVF eyepiece viewfinder right here. To turn on the EVF viewfinder, you do need to go into the settings and change if it turns on or not. Currently, these cameras have them turned off. To zoom in and out of the lens, there is a zoom function here on the top of the handle. There is also a way to turn the zoom function on and off right here. There's a high speed, a low speed, and an off for this button. There's also, on the side right here, another zoom function. You can even put your hand in the handle like this to carry around the camera. This zoom function is speed variant. So if you press it in a little bit, it'll zoom slowly. If you press it in all the way, it'll zoom fast. You can change how fast it zooms in the settings. Next to the main zoom function, there is an expanded focus button. The expanded focus button is used to digitally zoom in so you can manually focus on a subject. Next to this, there is a record review button. This record review button will show you what your last recording looked like. Back here where your thumb goes, there's a record start stop button. On the back of this camera, there are several ins and outs, which are mostly SDI ports, and there's an HDMI port. Usually you won't be using that unless you're running this to another system. On the top of this camera, you have a 1/4-20 mount, a hot shoe mount. This piece is also the internal microphone. So you can have an internal microphone, which is on the camera, or on the side here, there's also two XLR in ports. These ports also have phantom power, so if your mic needs phantom power, you can do that. Just up above the two XLR ports, there is a mic mount. You can put a shotgun mic in here and run all of your audio through one camera. Just behind where the LCD screen is, there's a set of buttons. These buttons are used to control the menu, and they are used to control your thumbnails. Next to the zoom function on the handle, there is a secondary start, stop, record button. There's also a hold function on this button. The hold function allows you to start or stop recording, and if you press the record button again while hold is on, it will not stop recording. If it's not recording, it will not start recording. This just allows you, if you accidentally press a button, it won't change functions. On the left side of the camera, just below the eyepiece, there is a headphone jack. This way you can listen to your audio while recording. On the left side of the camera is where most of your buttons and controls are gonna be. There is your audio control. You can choose for each channel of XLR input. There is two channels, channel 1 and channel 2. You can choose if the mic is the interior mic, which is the on-camera mic, or if it's an exterior mic, which you plugged in through the XLR ports. You can then choose if the camera chooses the audio levels for you, or if you manually change the audio levels. If you choose to manually change the audio levels, then you can change this knob from 0 to 10 to adjust the audio levels of your mic. Down here below the audio, there's another way to control the menu. You can press this menu button to get to the menu, use the scroll wheel to scroll through the menu, and you can press cancel to get back. The scroll wheel also acts as a button. Next to this menu control option, there are two switches. One is for your white balance and one is for your gain. White balance has three sets. You can change what these sets are in the menu. There's an A, a B, and a preset. These change when you press the white balance button. The gain function is basically like ISO. It electronically or digitally increases the brightness of the image. This will also add grain to your image. There's a high, a medium, and a low function for this. You can change how much gain each button does in the settings. Just under the lens, there's a white balance button. Press this and the camera will take a white balance of what it thinks is the proper white balance for your situation. To get the correct white balance, you'll want to use a white piece of paper or anything that you can find that is close to white. Next to the audio, there's a set of buttons. One button is for full auto. This will make the camera do everything for you and all you have to do is press record. One of them is for picture profile. You can save picture profiles in the camera and come back to them later if you want to. Then there is five buttons which you can assign functions to. Two of them are already assigned, but you can still change those in the setting. One of them is peaking or histogram. One of them is zebra, which tells you what is overexposed. And then there is three more assigned buttons. One of the functions I like to assign to buttons on these cameras is called marker. This basically assigns guidelines to the LCD so you can see in a wide aspect ratio. There are several options to change what these assigned buttons do in the settings menu. Next to the assigned buttons, there is a shutter on off button. As you may be able to tell, this turns on and off the shutter. Generally, you don't need to mess with that. This camera has the option to have a shutter speed or a shutter angle. Continuing towards the lens, there is an ND filter switch. This camera has two built-in ND filters. An ND filter is basically a piece of glass that is dark so that when you're outside, you can darken your image without raising the aperture and keep a nice shallow depth of field. So this camera has an 1/8 and a 1/64 ND. The bigger the fraction of ND, the more stops of light an ND filter will cut. On the lens, there are three different switches. One is to change between auto and manual iris, which is your aperture. The second switch is to turn macro focus on and off. This allows the camera to focus on objects close to the lens. The third switch is for auto or manual focus. If you're in manual focus, you can push this auto AF or autofocus button, which will temporarily have the camera autofocus for you, but it won't continue to autofocus after that. If you'd like to go full manual focus, you can take this focus ring on the lens and push it back, and you'll see this orange line, and the camera will not autofocus no matter what. This also will make the focus ring have a definite stop on each end, otherwise in autofocus, the ring will continue to spin forever. On the bottom of the camera, there's a switch to turn on and off the servo motor. If you turn off the servo motor, you can then come over to the zoom function on the lens and manually zoom. You can easily zoom really fast for crash zooms, or maybe speed up your zoom really weirdly. Make sure if you turn off the servo motor to turn it back on when you're done, so that someone using it after you doesn't get confused. On the bottom of this camera, there are 3/4-inch mounts to mount to a tripod, as well as over here a 3/8 mount, which is another common mount type. If you ever need to clean the lens, you can turn this knob right here, twist this matte box counterclockwise, and then you have easy access to the lens. To get this back on, put it to about the same position, bring it back clockwise, and then tighten the knob back. Now that we've looked at all the exterior buttons on this camera, let's look at the LCD display and then go through the menu. On the LCD display, it'll show you all kinds of numbers and information about what your camera is doing and what settings it currently has. You can change any of the information that displays on this LCD in the settings menu. Generally, it's going to give you information like what aperture you're at, what zoom you're at, if you're at shutter angle or shutter speed, how many minutes you have left on the battery, how many minutes you have left on the SBIS card to record, and other information like that. If you click the thumbnail button up here below the LCD screen, it'll take you to all your thumbnails. You can then scroll through all your thumbnails and play or fast forward to zoom, go through your thumbnails. To get back, you can just press the stop button. If you press the menu button, it'll open this dialog screen. As you can see, there are 6 sections in the menu. Most of the menu you don't need to know and you don't need to mess with. To get into one of these sections, you can click select or you can click onto the dial knob. The first section is about setting up your gain, your shutter, your white balance, your zoom speeds, and some other basic functions of the camera. To get back, you can press the arrow at the top or you can just press cancel and it'll take you back a menu screen. To get out of the menu, all you do is press menu again. The second section has to do with setting up your audio controls. You can change levels and change automatic settings and other options like that. Your third menu has to do with your outputs that are on the back. This will change what quality or resolution the camera outputs to whatever source you have, and generally you don't need to touch this. The third section has to do with setting up your LCD and monitoring functions. You can change what information is displayed on the LCD when you're looking at your recording. You can change the functions of your histogram and the functions of your zebra pattern to how much exposure sets those functions off. The fifth section has to do with timecode, user's bit, and timecode function. This you don't really need to touch and you don't need to worry about it. The sixth section has information like how to assign functions to buttons that are on the side of the camera, how to change the resolution of the camera, which is under system, and how to format the media card to erase all data on it. These are the 3 important functions in this section, but there are a lot of other functions. That is the menu. And I know there's a lot of options and a lot of fancy words, but most of it you don't need to touch and you don't need to change. It is good to know what is in there and it is good to understand it and it is good to maybe learn over time what is in there, but you don't need to know most of what's in the menu if the camera is already set up. When you hit one of the record buttons, on the LCD screen, there will be a little red dot that says record, and there will also be a little red light on the front of the camera. When your memory card is almost full, the camera will begin to beep. So now that we've gone over how to use the camera, let's go over how to set up an external audio source. You can start by taking the end of the XLR and plugging it into the back of the mic. Make sure that the 3 pins align correctly. When you put it in, you'll hear a snap. Next, you can unsnap this top bit, open it up, and put the mic inside. Now, if the mic is too small, I'd say you can use something to buffer in between there or add some gaff tape around it to make it a tight fit. If it is a phantom powered mic, you would turn on phantom power. If it is not a phantom power mic, turn off phantom power. Make sure to always have your camera off while plugging in microphones, especially while plugging in phantom powered mics. The MKE600 can take a battery power on the inside of the mic, or it can run through phantom power. For this sake, we're gonna run through battery power. We will switch phantom power off, and then we will look at the 3 pins on the back of this XLR port and plug it into the same way into the 3 pins on the camera. We will hear it snap and then boom. When you're taking this out, make sure to press this pin, metal pin right here in, and then pull the XLR out. If you don't push this pin in, you will ruin the XLR. Using the headphone jack, you can then listen to the audio coming from the mic. On the side here is where you then change channel 1 from an internal mic to the external mic. If you like to have the camera change your audio levels, set it to auto, and then you can use this knob in manual to change the audio levels. You can then turn the camera on, open the LCD screen. Right here, it'll show you little bars that keep changing as it picks up more of the microphone. If it goes into the red, that means your levels are too high. Generally, you want to keep your levels between negative 20 and negative 12. On this camera, it doesn't specifically show you the numbers, but it does show you a general idea. If you'd like to use a wireless lav mic setup with this camera, you need one of these wireless receivers. You would plug in one of the wireless transmitters onto your Talent with a lav mic connected, and then you would connect one of these, either a Sennheiser or a Sony wireless receiver to your camera. For both of these wireless receivers and transmitters, we have a hot shoe mount adapter. This will allow you to connect your receiver onto the top of the camera and then have it in a secure place. We can then take an XLR to 3.5 millimeter adapter like this one, plug the 3.5 millimeter into the wireless receiver. Plug the XLR while making sure to match the pins correctly into channel 1 or channel 2. You can then change all your audio settings on the side and in the settings. Another advantage to using these cameras is that most DSLRs don't have a servo motor to zoom, and most cameras' autofocus does not work well. The continuous autofocus on this camera I've been using all throughout this video. It works very well. Most cheap DSLR cameras also do not have a fixed aperture lens. No matter how far in or out you are zoomed, the aperture will stay the same, and this lens will stay at f1.9 no matter what. This means you can zoom in and out, and your exposure will not change. This is very useful and only available on nicer lenses. Thanks for watching. I hope you learned something about the Cable 8 XD cams. If you have any questions, put a comment in the section below. I'm Luke, and this is Pepper Cowboy. If you want to check out one of these cameras, contact your Cable 8 production manager. Have a good one.